I want to come to the synagogue. It's kind of, as you know, we don't know exactly when the synagogues were started. There's a lot of debate about that. Toward the end of Old Testament history, this way emerged to worship God. Most scholars believe it was during the exile, driven by the destruction of the temple and all that was involved in that. Jewish tradition identifies Ezra as the founder of the synagogue. Can't be sure, but you know that wherever there were 10 Jewish males, a synagogue could be formed, and they met, still meet, on the Sabbath, or Saturday, in honor of the creation rest. And the chief articles of furniture in the synagogue, both in the first century synagogue as well as today, are for the chest or ark for the scrolls of the scripture and the platform or pulpit for the reading. That goes back to Ezra. On every Sabbath, the service, you know, we're talking now first century, the service centered on the reading and explaining of the word. Here's Philo describing the synagogue worship. Quote, "They come to the holy places called synagogues. According to their age in order, the young men sit under the elders at their feet and with a decent composure attend to the hearing. When one taking the book reads, and another one of the most skillful explains what is not known." So this is time of Christ, synagogue. There would be the reading of the scripture and then the explaining of that portion of scripture by one who was capable of doing that. Alfred Edersheim, in his book Sketches of Jewish Life, writes this of the synagogues: "The teaching part of the service consisted mainly in reading a section from the law, with which the reading of a portion from the prophets and a sermon or address were conjoined." So you had the reading of the law, a reading from something of the prophets, and a sermon or address joined to those readings. This is Edersheim in Sketches of Jewish Life. Edersheim goes on to say, "The main object of the synagogue was the teaching of the people." We're back to the role of the Levites, the role of the scribes, the role of the priests. He says, "This was especially accomplished by the reading of the law. The reading of the law was followed by a lesson from the prophets." And then, as he said before, both were explained. The readings were explained. Often the readings and the related sermons followed the order of the scripture. In other words, they were consecutive. So week to week, you read the next section of scripture and it was explained. This is what happened in the synagogue worship. There were times, we know, when liberty was left to the individual teacher as to what section was read. One possible example was Luke 4, verse 17, where it says of Jesus, "The book of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him, and he opened the book and found the place where it was written," you know, from Isaiah. That's a possible example of Jesus choosing his own reading, but it is equally possible that the text is saying Jesus simply found the place in Isaiah that was the assigned reading for the day. That is equally possible in that text. So we can't be sure there. But ordinarily, in the synagogue, in the first century synagogues where Jesus and the Apostle Paul ministered, there was a lectionary. There was a systematic, consecutive reading of the scripture, the law and the prophets, and then a sermon joined to the reading. We're talking about consecutive exposition. Now, we wouldn't argue, I wouldn't argue that those were necessarily models of what exposition should be, but I want you to see that the principle of consecutive exposition was followed. The sermons that followed the readings, Edersheim argues, were normally expositions of the scripture. So in other words, you read the passage you left off from last week, and then someone explained it. That was the pattern of the synagogue worship. Now keep that in mind as we go to the next biblical argument, the pattern of Christ. The pattern of Christ. Our Lord's ministry was one of reading and teaching the word. One of the main emphases, this is really important to understand, one of the main emphases of Jesus' earthly ministry was teaching in the synagogues on the Sabbath. Now, don't forget what we just learned happened in the first century synagogues. Let's look at some of this. Turn to Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verse 14. And Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through all the surrounding district. Now watch verse 15. Here's how his ministry emphasis began. He began teaching in their synagogues and was praised by all. All around Galilee. That includes, next verse, his hometown, verse 16. He came back from Capernaum, or from the rest of Galilee, I should say. He's going to initiate Capernaum as his ministry headquarters after this. He came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, verse 16, and as was his custom, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. He took the book of the prophet Isaiah that was handed to him. He opened the book, found the place where it was written there in Isaiah 61. And we have the quote. He closed the book, verse 20, gave it back to the attendant and sat down. The eyes of all the congregation were fixed on him. And notice, he began to say to them, what does that imply? This isn't all he said. What's he doing? He's doing what was always done. The text was read, it was explained. And in explaining this text, what does Jesus have to explain? It's about me. Jesus was an expository preacher. He read the text, he explained the text. He read the text, he explained the text. Now, after he was rejected at Nazareth, he continued teaching and preaching in the synagogues in Galilee. Look at chapter 4, verse 31. And he came down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and he was teaching them on the Sabbath. Again, he's in the synagogue, participating in the normal routine of what happened in synagogue worship, the consecutive reading of the Scripture, the explaining of the Scripture. This was Jesus' practice. Look at verse 44. So he kept on preaching in the synagogues of Judea, not only Galilee, but Judea. It could be that's a reference, as you see in the marginal note there, to the larger area of the land of Israel, but we can't be absolutely sure of that. Now, notice chapter 6, verse 6. On another Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and was teaching. Go over to chapter 13. Chapter 13, verse 10. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. This was his pattern. Now, when you understand this and you marry it with what clearly went on in first century synagogues, you understand what Jesus was doing. He was having the next passage, consecutive passage in the reading read, and he was explaining it. He was a consecutive expositor. This was the thrust of his ministry. Yes, he taught the people out in the open fields. We have lots of examples of that from boats in the Sea of Galilee, in the temple in Jerusalem, in all kinds of different venues. But clearly, the main focus of his ministry, what he did week in, week out, was preach in the synagogue, where the Scripture was read and he explained it, where the next text was read and he explained it. As you would expect, the people responded to Jesus' teaching. Matthew 7, the end of Matthew 7 tells us that the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority and not as their scribes. And Luke 19, 48 says all the people were hanging on to every word he said. This is how our Lord taught. When you examine the ministry of Jesus then, you find that his ministry, particularly his participation in corporate worship in the weekly synagogue services, centered on the consecutive reading and exposition of the Word of God. Very briefly, another way we can see the biblical argument played out, and I'm not going to spend really any time here, is the pattern of the New Testament church. In Acts 2:42, the people were devoted to what? The apostles' doctrine, the apostles' teaching. In chapter 6, verse 4, the apostles there in the church in Jerusalem are distracted by what? By the need for the Hellenistic widows. And they say, we're going to appoint some men to do this because we must be devoted to the Word of God, the ministry of the Word, and to prayer. This was the focus of their lives, just as it had been the focus of their Lord's. Paul, by the way, you read the book of Acts, Paul was often in the synagogues teaching. What was he doing? The same thing our Lord was doing. The passage read, Paul explains. The passage read, explained. Again, there were variations to this. There was some liberty offered where a visiting rabbi could choose his own passage and have it read and explained. But the normal pattern was the one I've shared with you. And I would argue that shows us the pattern that we should follow as well. You look at I mentioned the apostles. You look at the New Testament elders. We've already talked about their responsibility is primarily to teach. That's what distinguishes them from deacons. They're 1 Timothy 5:17, to labor in teaching and preaching. By the way, sometimes people ask me, is there biblical warrant for paid elders and lay elders? This is a side note, but 1 Timothy 5:17 is the only one I know of, okay? It clearly is implied. In fact, it's put this way. Paul says in 1 Timothy 5:17 and 18, he says, you have all the elders. Let's do our Venn diagram. Some of you remember this from school. Okay, you have elders. And then he says, I want certain elders to be paid, those who rule well. That doesn't mean the other elders rule poorly. They should be dismissed if that's true. He's saying there's some who excel in their leadership in the church, especially melista, which is a word, which is a subset now of the other category, especially of those who rule well, especially those who labor at teaching and preaching. He says, I want them, those who rule well, to be paid. That's the next verse. They're worthy of double honor. And then he quotes from Luke, quotes from Deuteronomy. And so clearly in that passage, you have a differentiation between elders. There are elders who are to be paid. They're the ones who rule well, that is, who excel, and especially those who are gifted at teaching and preaching and are set aside to do that. But they're out of a larger body of elders. These then have to be unpaid elders or lay elders. Okay? Just FYI. I think that's something a lot of people stumble over. But biblically, there is justification for it. All right, so the New Testament elders were to have teaching as their highest priority. And of course, you have the commands to the church. The priority of the ministry of the Word is clear in the commands given to the church. The Old Testament, as well as the growing body of New Testament-inspired documents, were to be read and taught in the corporate worship. We just saw it when we began this morning in 1 Timothy 4. What did he tell Timothy to do? I want you to read Scripture, and I want you to teach. I want you to exhort, and I want you to instruct. Read the Scripture, teach the Scripture. But not only the Hebrew Old Testament, Paul's letters were to be read as well. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 27. I adjure you by the Lord to have this letter read to all the brethren. In other words, you have just as high a responsibility to have this letter, this New Testament document read, as the Hebrew Scripture. And again, there is every indication, the clear implication is that they are to be read as they were received. In other words, the guy reading 1 Thessalonians to the congregation didn't like skip the parts he didn't want to read. He read the letter Paul wrote. And the implication is then that whatever needed to be explained was explained just as it was with the pattern they were accustomed to with the reading of the Old Testament Scripture. Ordinarily, then, the reading would have been consecutive. So the word has always been central in the worship of God. It's always been the key element of worship. And the ministry of the word, this is what I want you to get, the ministry of the word has commonly, ordinarily, been the systematic, consecutive reading and then explaining of God's word. That is the pattern. And that's why there's so much historical warrant from the Reformation on, because they saw that. They saw these things and said, that makes sense. They looked at the theological arguments, like the argument for inspiration, the practical arguments we looked at, as well as the biblical arguments, when you see the pattern of worship in the Old Testament and even in the ministry of our Lord. So those are some of the arguments that the normal pattern of our preaching should be systematic, consecutive exposition. Now, any questions about all of that? I know I said I wasn't going to spend a lot of time there. We spent about what I planned, but I know there's a lot more that we could delve into, a lot of passages we could turn to, et cetera. But any questions about the general gist or trend of what I've discussed this morning? Okay, then let's move on then to the repeatable process for consecutive exposition. This is where we're going to spend the remainder of our time this week. As I began, let me just reiterate, the only way our weekly sermons will be biblically accurate and consistently clear is to create and follow a defined process, a repeatable, sustainable process that when you're faced with the next passage, the next paragraph, you have steps you will follow to produce a consistent exegesis and a consistently clear and fresh sermon. Now, as we begin to work through the process itself, having laid the foundation, let me just give you a couple of caveats, and these are very important for you to understand. First of all, don't hear me up here presenting myself as a preaching expert. Okay? It's not that I do everything the way you ought to do it in preaching. I'm still learning as well. Remember 1 Timothy 4:15, let your progress be evident to all. We're all merely at different levels and stages of that progress toward what we want to be as preachers. So I'm going to present a lot of things that I've learned, men who've explained things to me, men on whose shoulders I stand, but I'm with you in the process. So make sure you understand that. It's important for me to go through these things, but don't hear me if you go listen to every message I've ever done and say, well, Tom, well, boy, that was not that. Okay? I understand that. You know, we all, in fact, I can't tell you how often I will finish preaching a message and sit down and say to myself, wow, that was a dog. Okay? That didn't do at all what I really had hoped and wanted it to do. For your encouragement, when I was in John's office, several times I heard him say the same thing. So it encourages me that all preachers feel that way. So get used to it. All right? And I'm certainly not saying that I've arrived. I just need you to know that. Secondly, I'm not suggesting that you follow my process exactly. However, you do need a repeatable process. And you do need to include all of the elements that we'll cover this week. And you will need to follow a similar workflow simply because it is the logical path. But there's room for each of our personalities and giftedness and approaches to be absorbed here, okay? Let me give you another caveat. We're not going to be able to deal with every issue in detail. As you can already tell, I'm kind of wired that way. And we're not going to be able to deal with everything as well as I'd like to deal with it. The issue of time factors in. Number four, feel free to ask questions, okay? I know so far it's kind of been heavy on the data dump side, and that's intentional to some extent, but they're going to need to be give and take as we get into the process, because I know you'll have specific questions related to your situation. So with that said, we need to first review, as we start looking at the process, we need to first review the two most important words for a preacher, because these two words summarize everything preachers do. Okay? Everything we do comes down to two basic words. First one is exegesis. And the second one is exposition. These words obviously have a lot of overlap. There's a lot of semantic overlap between them, but there is an important distinction, and it's the one that we want to make for our purposes here this week. Exegesis means to draw out from a text all the truth that's in it. That's to exegete. To exposit is to expose, to make visible, to make known. It is to show something for what it really is. So exegesis is to draw out of the text the meaning that's there. To exposit is to expose that meaning to others. It suggests shedding light on a subject. Expository preaching includes both of these. It begins with exegesis and it ends with exposition. Without exegesis, a sermon is merely human speech. It's a human talk, an inspirational message or whatever. Without exposition, the message will only be a technical collection of details that you've garnered in your study. So we need these two parts of the process, and we need to examine these two parts of the process. And my approach is going to be to review each step in the process of exegesis, of studying the text, and each step in the process of creating an exposition. And we're going to illustrate what each step in the process looks like using specific illustrations from Romans chapter 1. And the book of Romans as a whole, but primarily Romans 1 is where we'll focus, just in the interest of time. All right, so I need to also tell you that this is the process I follow every week. You know, I have all the demands that you have as pastors. I counsel, I meet with people, I have things I need to do, correspondence, emails, letters to respond to, text messages, have all of those things, hospital visits. I do all of those things. And I have to be prepared to preach on Sunday like you do. I can tell you from experience, this process is a workable process. It will enable you to produce consistently a sermon that you need to produce that hopefully reflects, the goal is to reflect the original authorial intent of the passage in a way that's clear and that then can be applied to the lives of the listeners. So, Here's where we are. This is back to the overview of the Winterim. We've looked at the foundation, the introduction, reviewing the biblical foundations, both the foundational presuppositions of expository preaching, the fact that the Scripture is inspired, the fact that it's relevant, that it's sufficient, that it's authoritative, and therefore we approach our ministry of the Word that way. And then we've looked at some of the primary arguments for consecutive exposition. So we move on then to really the first major block of material, and this is where we'll spend several days, exegesis, studying the biblical text. Walt Kaiser writes, exegesis is the practice of and set of procedures for discovering the author's intended meaning. What is the lay expression for exegesis? When a layman talks about doing exegesis, how do they usually refer to it? Inductive Bible study. You've heard that expression, inductive Bible study. That is what we would call, in a more technical sense, exegesis. It is an approach to the Scripture that starts with the particulars, and from understanding those particulars, arrives at the meaning of an individual passage. One common illustration, perhaps you've heard this illustration, of the difference between inductive study and other more common approaches is, imagine for a moment that you've decided, and why you'd want to do this, I don't know, but that you decided you wanted to study frogs, okay? One approach, there are two basic approaches you could take if you decided you want to study frogs. Approach number one is you could simply assemble all the books that you can discover about frogs, all of the experts who've written on frogs, and you could read everything they've written. You could learn about their life cycle, their habitat, their diet, etc. What's the problem with this approach? What's the chief problem with taking this approach to learning about frogs? What's that? Yeah, you've never had the opportunity to observe firsthand. What else are you doing? Where are you getting your data? Yeah, you are having to completely, implicitly trust the experts who are telling you this is what's true about frogs, because you don't have a clue if that's true about frogs or not. And if the experts disagree, now you're in big trouble, because how do you discern between them? That's one approach you could take. The second approach you could take if you wanted to learn about frogs was you could spend the next year personally studying frogs. You could spend days, weeks at the local ponds observing, taking careful notes about all aspects of their behavior. You could keep a couple of living frogs in your home so that you could continue to observe how they live and how they behave. And if one of your frogs dies, you could take its slimy little body and pin it to a board and dissect it and cut it apart and examine the constituent parts of a frog. Study its anatomy firsthand. And when you're done with that study, you would have a thorough inductive knowledge of frogs. Then, if you're smart, you would still read the experts. Why? Because you don't fully imagine that you have been able to see everything there is to know about frogs. You're also aware that some of your deductions may not have been accurate. And so, in addition to your firsthand study, the second approach says, I'm going to do the firsthand study first. I'm going to learn myself about frogs, and then I'm going to read the experts. You would see much in what the experts write of what you already learned in observation. You would also learn new facts, but you would be in a much better place to evaluate those new facts accurately, because you know a lot about frogs firsthand. And now you can say, if the experts disagree, you can evaluate their arguments based on what you know firsthand, and you can come to a conclusion about the disagreement. So when it comes to Bible study, these are your two options. Sadly, and I tell you this, I know this happens, many pastors opt almost exclusively for the first option. It's their study day, and what do? They break the commentaries off the shelf, they pile them on the desk, and they begin to read through the commentaries. This is the first approach they take. They read through the commentaries, they read through all of them, they make little notes, they highlight, they write down some good quotes, and then from that secondhand expert's observations, they create a message. The problem with that is all the same problems we just talked about with the frogs. Number one, you're relying on the experts. You don't know that's true. You're just taking them at their word. And if they disagree, and I hate to tell you this, commentators disagree a lot. How are you going to decide between them? And on it goes. But this is what many pastors opt to do. They simply read the experts. The better approach in any discipline is a healthy measure of inductive firsthand study. Why? Well, there are a lot of ways to answer that question. I love, while I'm not a huge Howard Hendricks fan, I like what he wrote about this. Listen to what he writes. Knowledge that is self-discovered is stored in the deepest part of the mind and remains the longest in the memory. There is no jewel more precious than that which you have mined yourself. It's absolutely right. The truth that you discover in the process we're talking about, the process of exegesis, it will impact your soul. It will shape you in ways being sort of a synthesizer of the experts will never do. Now, the process of inductive Bible study or exegesis involves several steps. I've put here, if you read John's work on understanding sort of the flow of this process of exegesis, he has these four steps: observation, interpretation, evaluation, and, because he's primarily talking about personal Bible study, application. In the process of sermon preparation, I think application is involved in exegesis, because you're listening, you're thinking about how this text is supposed to apply to you, and therefore ultimately how it'll apply to your people. But I think it comes a little later in the process, more in the crafting of the exposition. I'll talk about that. So I wouldn't include that. I have reduced this process to five distinct steps. First of all, preparation. Preparation. Secondly, observation. That's key. Thirdly, meditation. We'll talk about that when we get there. I think meditation is one of the most underrated spiritual disciplines. I don't think there's anything you will do that's more important in your sermon preparation than meditation. And we'll talk about why, what the Bible says about it and how to do it. Number four, interpretation. Now that you've pulled together the data, now that you've considered, you've meditated on the text, you've thought through it, all of the work that you did in observation, you're ready to come to an interpretive decision. This is what this text means. And then evaluation. Evaluation is when you bring the experts in. This is when you bring the commentators and the resources you have on your shelf that are commenting on that specific passage to bear. Is an evaluation. When you are evaluating the fruit of your own firsthand inductive study to see if others agree, and if not, why. And we'll talk about, that's very important. Evaluation is crucial, because if the Spirit of God inspired the Scripture, and if He's illumined the generations of believers before us, and you arrive at a text that is singularly unique, or an interpretation rather, that is singularly unique of that passage, then something went wrong. Either all the Christians before you missed it, or you strayed somewhere in the process. So evaluation is very important. I'm not downplaying the role of experts. I'm just saying it'll come later than at that initial stage. All right? So that's where we're going. Preparation, how to prepare to study it. Observation, this is what it says, what the text says. Meditation, this is thinking deeply about what you've learned. Interpretation, this is what it means. Observation is what it says. Interpretation is what it means. Evaluation, this is what others say it means. Okay? So that's where we're going in the process of exegesis. Any questions? Sort of that roadmap is really important to grasp and make sure you've got where we're going. Yes, sir.
The application, would you say that comes in another, not under exegesis, but under something?
Yeah, where does application fall in this? Well, in honesty, it occurs in two places. It does occur in exegesis under meditation, because one of the goals of meditation is not only to gain insight into the meaning of the text, but also to think about how to apply it. I'll show you that from several passages on meditation. And so that happens there. But I'm still not necessarily thinking, how does this passage apply to those people I'll be speaking to on Sunday? Here, I'm thinking about how it applies to me, what I'm supposed to do with this text in light of what I've learned. I think the reason I put it under exposition is I think normally when we talk about application, we're talking about applying it to the people we're talking to. Now, I'm going to include what I've thought about in meditation about myself, because it applies that way to me, it applies that way to them too. But I think that's part of building the body of the message later. So it shares some in both parts, would be an accurate way to say it, but I just think from a sermon building standpoint, it makes sense to include it in the exposition side. Yeah. Anything else? All right, well, let's move on then. We're looking at preparation. That's where we're starting. We're not going to get any farther than that, let me just tell you, in the 45 minutes we have remaining. So this was my plan, actually. I hope to start We'll just start observation today if I get where I want to get, but we'll expand it tomorrow significantly. All right? So, preparation. When we look at exegesis or studying the biblical text, the first step in exegesis is preparation. The other four steps have to do with the text we're studying. But this first step has to do with preparing ourselves and our surroundings to make them amenable for careful study. So what preparations are necessary to be an effective expositor? First of all, you have to prepare yourself. Now, I understand this is very basic, but it's so basic it needs to be said, okay? First of all, you must be regenerate. You must be regenerate. Our Lord makes it very clear on a number of occasions in his ministry. John 8:43, why do you not understand what I am saying? It is because you cannot hear my word. The Greek word is dunamai. You don't have the capacity, you don't have the ability to understand my word. Now, that doesn't mean at a surface level the Bible can't be understood by unregenerate people. I have commentaries on my shelf written by men who likely were unbelievers. Okay, there were technical commentaries, etc. But I wonder sometimes when I read some of what they write if they really even knew the Lord. But they understood the flow of the language. What we're saying here is you can't understand and grasp it in a spiritual, life-changing way. You may get the core meaning, but the real impact is completely lost on you. So you have to be regenerate. By the way, if you want a very interesting study on the issue of human depravity, go through the New Testament looking up all occurrences of the word dunamai in reference to unbelievers. It's a fascinating study. All the things that the New Testament says unbelievers cannot. They do not have the capacity to do. And you'll get a powerful lesson in total depravity. There are about 8 of them, if I remember right. 8 of those sort of statements where it says you cannot do something. Now, for example, Romans 8, they cannot please God, etc. It's quite interesting. You know, Jesus' comment in John 6, you dunamai, you cannot come to me unless the Father draw you. It's fascinating. So anyway, whatever that's worth, that'd be a good study on human depravity. In John 10:27, Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. He's not talking about some, you know, Jesus calling book, you know, where some woman who is misled thinks Jesus is, you know, giving her revelation. He's talking about in his word, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. They hear it, and they follow it. So there are other passages, of course, as well. I won't go there. I don't want to belabor the point, but you get the idea. I don't want to assume that everyone here this morning is regenerate. You know, Spurgeon estimated that 40% of his church were true believers. I don't know what percentage of my church, but I'm promising you there are plenty of people in my church who are not believers. I know some of them because they're brought by their spouses or parents or whatever, but there are others I'm sure I don't know because Jesus said in Matthew 7, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we do all these things? And I'll say, I never knew you. And so I don't want to assume that. I just want to underscore that this whole process is a worthless exercise if you don't have the Spirit. If you don't have what John refers to in 1 John as the anointing, that is a regenerate heart produced by the Spirit. So it starts there. Second stage of preparing yourself, you have to deal with your sin. You must have a repentant heart. Look at 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 2. You remember the pictures that Paul gives here to Timothy of what ministry is like. And one of those pictures one of the chief dangers of ministry. Look at verse 5. Also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. What's he saying about ministry? He's saying that one of the chief dangers of ministry is defilement or disqualification because of sin. We have to deal with the sin in our lives. We have to confess our sin. That has to be a regular pattern and practice of our lives. Turn over to James chapter 1. James is talking here about, you know, our response to the Scripture. Verse 19, really down through the end of the chapter, is all about our response to Scripture. And he says, "This you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God." What's he talking about? He's not saying you need to stop talking and listen more to your wife. It's not what he's saying. In the context of this paragraph, he's talking about our response to the Scripture. He's saying, listen to the Scripture. Be quick to listen to the Scripture. And don't be quick to talk back to the Scripture. And don't get angry at what it tells you. Instead, verse 21, "Therefore, in light of this, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, in humility receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls, but prove yourselves doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves." You're familiar with this passage. But notice the image that James uses in verse 21. Putting aside. It's a familiar New Testament image. It refers to taking off clothing. It's used in Ephesians 4 and other passages of metaphorically. It refers to taking off evil attitudes and behaviors that were a part of who we were before Christ. The sanctification process. Specifically here, notice James says, taking off all filthiness. That's all that's morally dirty. And then he says, all that remains of wickedness. Literally, the Greek text says, the abundance of wickedness. In context, the word translated wickedness refers generally to all that's wicked, all that's evil. You see, it isn't that we have to be perfect to receive the word. It's that we have to be willing to let go of all that's dirty and all the abundance of wickedness. In other words, we first have to have a repentant heart. We must be willing to let go of anything the word tells us to let go of, no matter how much we may currently cherish it. Whether it's sinful acts or sinful ideas or doctrinal error. So repentance has to come first. Notice how James says it. Putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, receive the word. This is where it starts. You're going to study the Bible, you got to be regenerate, but you also got to be willing to deal with your sin. Don't imagine for a moment the Holy Spirit's going to open your mind to truly grasp the depth of His Word if you're clinging to and cherishing some unrepentant sin in your life. He says, in humility, receive the Word. So approach your study with repentance and humility. Put your hand over your mouth and let the Bible say what it says. Listen to what it says. Be ready to be taught. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, "Therefore, putting aside all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babies, long for the pure milk of the word." There it is again. Putting aside the sins in your life and then longing for the milk of the word that you may grow thereby. Again, it's basic, guys. I understand that. But I know what it looks like when you get into ministry and busyness. It's easy for your own spiritual life to suffer if you're not careful. It's easy to be sort of swept along by the busyness of ministry and the requirements of the next meeting and the next Sunday's coming and I got to be ready, and to neglect your own soul and neglect a truly repentant heart. This is prerequisite. You got to prepare yourself. You've got to be regenerate. You've got to have a repentant heart. Confess your sin. Deal with your sin. Number 3, with an attitude of humility and dependence, you must pray for illumination. J.I. Packer reminds us, quote, "One of the many divine qualities of the Bible is this, that it does not yield its secrets to the irreverent and the censorious." It's not going to open for the person who doesn't come with humility and dependence, recognizing we're out of our league when we come to the Scripture. Psalm 119, verse 18. I told you I'm in Psalm 119 and loving it. Listen to what the psalmist writes. "Open my eyes." This is his prayer. "God, open my eyes." Obviously, he doesn't mean his physical eyes. He's talking about the eyes of his understanding. "So that I may behold wonderful things from your law. Let me see the wonder that's there." Not just the basic understanding. Psalm 119, verse 73, "Your hands made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn your commandments." Psalm 119, verse 125, "I am your servant. Give me understanding that I may know your testimonies." And of course, you come to the New Testament. You have Ephesians 1:18. "I pray," Paul says, "that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know," you'll understand what you really have in Christ, the hope of his calling, the hope to which you've been called, the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. And look at Colossians 1. Colossians 1, verses 9 and 10, "For this reason also," he says, Paul, "since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you." And here's what we're asking, "that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding." Again, he's not talking here about, you know, what color car you're going to buy or where you're going to live, or, you know, he's not talking about the will of God in that sense, his sovereign will. He's talking about his revealed will. He's talking about the Scripture. "I want you to be filled with the knowledge of his will," verse 10, "so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects." So we pray. We pray for illumination. 1 John 2:27, "For as for you, the anointing which you receive from him," that is, I should say here, that is the Spirit's regenerating work, "abides in you, and you have no need for anyone to teach you." He's not talking about not needing teachers. The New Testament's filled with the need for teachers. He's talking about ultimately true believers are led by the Spirit of God into an understanding of the truth. "But as his anointing teaches you about all things, that is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you abide in him." Charles Spurgeon writes, "It is one of the peculiar offices of the Holy Spirit to enlighten his people. He has done so by giving us his inspired word. But the book is never spiritually understood by anyone apart from the personal teaching of its great author. You may read it as much as you will and never discover the inner and vital meaning unless your soul is led into it by the Holy Spirit himself. You may have done well to learn the letter of truth, but you still need the Spirit of God to make it the light and power of God to your soul." This is true of us, men, as ministers of the Word. You can prepare, I can tell you from personal experience, you can prepare a sermon following the process we're going to talk about and deliver it to your people and essentially get the truth of God across to your people in a way that will be life-changing to them because of the work of the Word and the Spirit, but that doesn't change you at all. We have to pray for illumination. What we're really saying is, "God, help me to grasp the truth in a life-changing way. Change me." The Children's Catechism, we taught our kids when they were young. One second, I'll answer that. Children's Catechism, when our kids were young, we taught them, and there were a couple of funny moments with that. My favorite moment in the Children's Catechism was I think she was about five at the time. We were here, living here in Santa Clarita, or up there in Santa Clarita, and my wife tells me the story. They were at the grocery store, and my five-year-old daughter had just been a pill all day. I mean, just really struggling with obedience, and I know you probably never had a day like that with your kids, but she was, and they got up to the front to the cash register. And of course, here in LA, everything's long. So there's a long line. You're waiting in line, and you know, people all around you. And my daughter started begging for the candy that's displayed noticeably there for the kids to have. And they came up on it, and my daughter said, "Mommy, you know, can I have some candy? I have some candy." And my wife said, "Not today, sweetheart. You don't deserve any candy the way you've been behaving." To which my daughter, in full voice, so that everybody, not only in her line, but in several cash registers over, heard the response, "I know, Mommy, all I deserve is the wrath and curse of God." She got it. But that wasn't quite what we had in mind. Another one of the children's catechism questions asks, why do I need Jesus to be my prophet? You remember this question? Why do I need Jesus to be my prophet? And the answer is, because I am ignorant. That's how we approach the Scripture. That's how you should approach the Scripture every time you sit down. I need the work of God to help me understand this because I am ignorant and in need of a teacher. That's the spirit that we come to the Scripture with. So before you begin to study the Bible, always be in a spirit of dependence and humility. Ask the Spirit of God to be your teacher. In preparing yourself, one final thing you must do, and that is you must commit to do the hard work. We already looked at 2 Timothy 2:15. Be diligent. It's interesting, the Greek word translated be diligent there is spoudazo. Bauer, which is my favorite sort of go-to lexicon, BDAG, some of you may know it as, translates or rather defines be diligent this way, spoudazo, to be especially conscientious in discharging an obligation, to be zealous, to take pains, to make every effort. That's be diligent. Let me read that again. This is from the lexicon. To be especially conscientious in discharging an obligation, to be zealous, to take pains, to make every effort to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. If you're going to be a serious student of God's word and a faithful expositor, you'll find that preparing 2 sermons a week is like researching and writing 2 10-page papers a week. And just like in seminary, that doesn't happen easily. Sermon preparation is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. You have to do the work to stay focused. And you have to do that because of the constant distractions. In fact, look back at 2 Timothy again. Let me show you. This is another danger of ministry. 2 Timothy 2, verse 3, suffer hardship with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier in active duty entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life so that he may please the one who enlisted him as a soldier. One of the chief enemies of ministry is distraction with the affairs of everyday life. Look at Acts 6, and one of the chief distractions people who are responsible to minister the word have is what? Other ministry. Oh, well, those, you know, those Hellenistic widows, they need to be cared for. Maybe we should do that. No, we're going to select others because we're going to be devoted to the ministry of the word. Ministry distractions. I lost you in your question. Sorry, go back.
I was just going to ask, in the preparation of yourself, would you recommend that outside of preparing for our understanding of the text that we're going to preach next Sunday, that we are committed to just meditating on the word on our own, at other portions in the Bible?
Yeah, good question. I could have included that here, you're right. The question is, if we're going to really be the right kind of expositor, shouldn't we be investing personal time daily in feeding our own souls from the Scripture outside of the preaching text? And the answer is absolutely. In fact, I need to edit my notes. That needs to be included. That's something for me that's a non-negotiable. Every day, I like to get up before everybody else is up, and depending on what time of the year it is, I'll either go sit outside on my back porch or I'll sit in my den with the fireplace going, and I'll have that time of my own study, meditation. I'll use occasionally some of that time to meditate on the passage, not to know how to preach it, but how to understand it and apply it to me. Most of the time, though, is invested outside of the preaching text. And like I said, I'm going through Psalm 119. I'm not preaching Psalm 119. Now, someday that may end up being a series, but that's not what I'm going through it for. Same thing I did with Psalm 23, for example, back last year, is I went through it in my own mind and my own study and my own meditation. It ended up being eventually a series, but I didn't go through it for that reason. But yeah, absolutely, absolutely. We have to feed our own souls. Let me tell you, that is a huge danger for people in seminary and people in ministry. In fact, let me just ask you a personal question. I don't want to show a hands far, but how many of you are investing daily time with the Lord in His Word and in prayer? That's the best preparation you can make for ministry. Nothing else you can do will substitute for that. And I know the danger. I've been there. I understand. The call of the urgent, you know, the things that got to be done. But somehow you've got to put that into your schedule. You've got to work that into your life as a priority. And that's true in ministry as well. If you find it hard in seminary, don't for a moment believe, well, when I get out of seminary, then it'll be easier. It's not true. That's a lie. All you guys in ministry, true? Yeah. So do it now. Start that discipline in your life now. No, absolutely. Thank you, brother. That's really important. So in terms of the hard work, distractions, you know, for us, those distractions include text messages, Facebook updates, Twitter, Snapchat, phone calls, emails, family, sports, ESPN, fantasy football leagues, you name it. You got to stay focused, guys. You got to be willing to do the hard work. It also requires a lot of time. When I was at Grace Church, John challenged us, if we were going to preach two sermons a week, and I know some of you won't be doing that. I did for the first 10 years of my ministry life at Countryside, and then we went to three services in the morning. The elders, just to preserve my life, had me go back to only doing Sunday night about 30-35% of the time during the year. But Sunday morning, I preached three times. And if you're preaching two sermons, two different sermons, John challenged us, as he was challenged in seminary, to invest 30 hours a week in study. By God's grace, I've done that. Whenever I've had two sermons to prepare for, I've invested 30 hours of my week. You say, wait a minute, the math doesn't add up. You know, 30 hours from 40 hours, you got 10 hours left to do all the other stuff. We'll talk about this on Saturday, Lord willing, but forget 40 hours. That's never going to happen, all right? But you got to be willing to invest the time. During my 16 years here at Grace, I often heard John in Q&As at various pastors' events, and one of the common questions that guys would ask is, like there was this Gnostic knowledge, you know, this Gnostic, they would say, so John, what's the secret to a long-term effective pulpit ministry? Expecting, you know, some hidden thing. And every time, always, here, around the world, I heard him explain this. Keep your rear in the chair till the work's done. That's it. There's no secret. Keep your rear in the chair until the work's done. It's hard work. It requires a lot of time. Every week of my life, I told John this recently, every week of my life, he sits on my shoulder saying, keep your rear in the chair till the work's done. R.C. Sproul writes, we fail in our duty to God's word, not so much because it is difficult to understand, not so much because it is dull and boring, but because it is work. Our problem is not a lack of intelligence or a lack of passion. Our problem is that we are lazy. Newspapers are easier to read than the Bible is to study. We could add web pages, whatever. You must prepare yourself. Secondly, you must prepare your surroundings. You must prepare your surroundings. And we're not going to spend a long time here, but I think it is important to note several things. First of all, have a set time, your best time of day if possible. You know, that some of us are morning people, others of us are evening people. whenever your mind is at its sharpest and best, try to protect set times to study. We're going to talk more about schedule, Lord willing, sort of the last thing we do on Saturday. But you need to have a set time to study. Secondly, you need to have a set place, a quiet place free of distractions. Listen, I've been there, done that. I translated one semester in graduate school. I had 6 months of translating papyri. And yes, I tried to do that in front of Monday Night Football. You need a place that's quiet and free of distractions. I know there are guys who study in Starbucks. Maybe if you're one of them, it works for you. You have your headphones or whatever. God bless you. Most of us can't work that way. Most of us, there are too many things that catch your eye. There are too many things that catch your ear. I need a place where I am undistracted, where I'm dead to the world. My wife will tell you, you know, she feels like she needs to, like it with the high priest, sort of tie a rope to my foot and a couple times a day just yank it to make sure I'm still alive when I'm in my study at home. You need to shut out. You need to have a quiet place, a set place. Number three, you need to turn off and shut out all distractions. Guys, this includes other people. Like when I am locked away to study at my church office, I have blinds on my windows. I close the blinds. Now, I never allow a female member, a female period, in my office with the door closed and the blinds closed. Never. But when I'm studying, I close my blinds because if somebody walks past that window and just catches my eye, they feel like they have me. Okay? Can I just ask you one question? And one question and the second question, and you know. So get rid, turn off, shut out all distractions. That includes people, doors, windows. When I'm studying in my home office, I close my door because I love my kids, and I don't mind their coming in occasionally, but I don't want them coming in just whenever they want all the time. That's a distraction. Electronic distractions. Guys, I know many of you are digital natives. I understand that, and I'm not. I'm older, etc. But don't you believe for a moment that it doesn't distract you to get the dings and the bells and they do. They distract you. Experts will tell you that when you allow yourself to be distracted by something that flashes across your screen, a bell that rings, and you glance at it, it takes you 2 to 5 minutes to really settle back in to your train of thought. So I would urge you on the days when you're really studying, shut all that out. Turn off all the dings and bells and all the messages that come across your screen. It's not that important. It's not more important than what you're doing. Number four, surround yourself with the necessary resources. What are those necessary resources? Well, this isn't a complete list, but here's some key resources. First of all, I would urge computer software. I'll deal with this a little more, not a lot. Just out of curiosity, how many of you use Logos as your primary study software? How many of you use BibleWorks as your primary software? Okay, how many of you use some miscellaneous, something else? What is it? Concordance. Okay. There are a lot of different approaches you can take. I'll tell you my own experience, for whatever it's worth, is Logos. I have both Logos and BibleWorks on my computer. Logos is great for print resources. You know, I find that, you know, if I want to look something up real quickly, I can do that with a quick search. It's easy to get around in that way. I also have Logos, honestly, just so I can have it on my iPad, because BibleWorks is not available on the iPad. But you can get, if you have Logos software, you can get it on your iPad with the same resources that you have open on your desktop. And so I use Logos probably, most of what I use Logos for, I use it on my iPad. But in my actual study of the text, in the exegesis part of studying the text, I personally have found BibleWorks is more streamlined for that. It's a little more academic in its approach. It's quicker. Doesn't have all the resources. Don't think, you know, lots of print books from the Puritans or whatever. We're not talking about any of that. We're talking about just like I purchased the BDAG add-on, so I have it really quickly at my fingertips when I'm studying. But you need... obviously, you all have Bible software. You're going to rely on that. You're going to use it a lot. We'll talk about some of that as we go along. if you don't yet have, well, I'm assuming all of you will eventually have the original language resources. You'll have studied Greek, studied Hebrew. You'll be able to use those resources. Until then, and I understand there are some who haven't yet sort of gotten to that stage. You're still in beginning languages, and you're not able to really use it with the text itself. Until then, what you need to use is an English translation based on the formal equivalence model. Let me tell you what I mean by that. There are three basic translation philosophies when you're talking about translating out of a receptor language or out of a language into a receptor language. First of all, there's formal equivalence. Formal equivalence is word-for-word equivalence as much as possible. Some English examples of that. The New American Standard is the standard in terms of formal equivalence. It can be a little wooden at times. It reads, you know, sometimes a little wooden, but as far as, it's as close as you can get, really, to formal equivalence, and it still read like English. English Standard Version's pretty good on that front. Of course, the King James Version was an early version, mostly not understood by people in today's world. Secondly, dynamic equivalence. This is the second approach. This is concept equivalence. In other words, the translator said this, I'm going to look at this Greek expression, I'm going to translate that into Greek thought. What concept was the author trying to get across? And then I'm going to translate that Greek concept into an English concept, and then I'm going to translate that English concept into English words. Now, they're more or less dynamic equivalent versions. The New International Version would be on the better end, the conservative end, more toward formal equivalence than some of these others. But the New English Bible, certainly the New Living Translation, is really up to its eyeballs in dynamic equivalence, concept equivalence. And then the final translation philosophy is paraphrase. This is the author's interpretation of the original. It's really nothing more than a commentary. It's what it amounts to. Phillips translation, the Living Bible, older paraphrase that's out there, maybe you've seen. But what you need to understand is that until you have the Greek resources or the Hebrew resources, or if you have the Greek resources but you don't yet have the Hebrew ones, you want as close to the original in your language as you can get, which means you want a formal equivalence Bible. The reason for that is they make decisions. Let me show you the difference. Here's Romans 3:21 in several different approaches. Look at the NAS. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness from God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. If you look at that in your Greek text, those of you who are knowledgeable in Greek, you'll see that that is not far from what the original language reads. But as you go down through this list, ESV is pretty good, but let's look down at the NLT, the New Living Translation. But now God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law as was promised in the writings of Moses and the prophets long ago. You see, the concepts are all there, but the words have been changed. What is the problem with relying on a dynamic equivalence translation to do Bible study? There you go. The translator is making all of those decisions for you. So you don't even know when you're using that what the text really said. He's made decisions about what it means, and he's telling you his decision. And so that's the problem. So until you get a certain level of expertise in Greek, a certain level of expertise in Hebrew, make sure when you're studying the text, you use a formal equivalence Bible. And of course, the best thing would be to have the original language resources, to have the knowledge of both the Greek and the Hebrew, which I know you're all getting in your toolbox. Another thing you need are some ready reference resources, some books that you sort of have wherever you study. I'm going to go through a little list of those in just a minute, for just a minute. You want commentaries? I would say somewhere between, if you can, 10 to 15 commentaries on a biblical book. If you're going to teach through a book for a couple of years, you make the investment, at least you need 5 or 6 minimum. But I would say, personally, 10 to 15 is a better number, because then you're getting a better sampling of the scholarship that's out there. I have them, for example, on Romans, I'll show you. I have more than 15, I forget now, that I have on my shelf that I'm going through each week. as I'm evaluating my study. Highlighters, markers, highlighters to mark the books you're reading when you read those. Markers, pens, nice pens. I love, at the early stage of my study, I love writing with a nice pen on a fountain pen on paper. Eventually, I transfer to computer. I'll talk about that when we get to process. Legal pad, just so you can keep track. It's very easy. You can tear off a page. You can throw it away. You can lay them out in front of you. Just a lot of benefits to keeping your initial study that way. Book stands. This is really handy. Something I wasn't told in seminary, but something somebody eventually told me. It's really handy. Have you seen those little metal stands they sell in the bookstore here, where you can prop up several books at a time? That's really nice for study. I have a set of five at my home office, a set of five at my church office, because that way I can have them all out at one time and compare, contrast. A bibliography. Let me just give you. This is. You don't need to add that. That's to remind me to go through a little bibliography with you. I mentioned those resources that you may want to have available. I'm going to give you this. You don't need to write it down. Obviously, you're not going to be able to, all of these books. But I just went through my ready reference section in both of my offices, my church office, my home office, and I listed the books that are sort of go-to books that I use fairly often, and I starred the ones with one star that are sort of, yeah, I would really suggest you get this. And I started the ones with two stars that I would say, oh boy, I rely on these all the time, okay? So I just, again, there's no, it's not like these are broken down by the Dewey Decimal System or something, but just in categories. Let me just walk through a few that I would recommend. There's several on quotations and general references. I always want to know, what did the early church fathers say about this issue or this passage? A Dictionary of Early Christian Beliefs by Burcott is really helpful to that. That can then send you to the original if you want to know more about it in context. I use the anthology of John Calvin's sort of quotes, Calvin's Wisdom, an anthology arranged alphabetically by a grateful reader. And again, it can point you to others. For basic facts, the World Almanac, Book of Facts, if I want to know how many Christians there are in the world, how many atheists, you know, all that kind of stuff is in there. Lloyd-Jones, the anthology of some quotes from Lloyd-Jones. Luther's is huge and very helpful. If you want to know what Martin Luther said about just about anything, this book, What Luther Says, A Practical In-Home Anthology for the Active Christian, it's like that. And, you know, he did a lot of sermons. There are a lot of them written. Really impossible for me every week to go in those individual volumes and discover what he said. But this is a great anthology done very academically and documented very well. I highly recommend it. Here's a big one, two stars, The Synonym Finder. Okay, you don't want to use the same word every time. And there is no better synonym book on the market than this one. It's recommended by William Sapphire, things like that, over 1 million synonyms. I have one in both offices and use it literally every week. Quotes Spurgeon, you need a couple of dictionaries. I have the shorter Oxford English Dictionary and Webster's Unabridged. Both are, you know, really helpful. You need to look up words, English words even, to know that you're using a word that makes sense and corresponds to the Greek word or the Hebrew word. As far as Greek language resources, I told you I really rely on Bauer a lot and find it to be consistently more helpful than the others. I use my 10 volumes of Kittle. I have it at home where I study for Sunday morning, and it's very helpful. There's some other resources here. Oh, here's one that's really important, guys. If you're going to use names in Scripture, proper names, places, people, you want to make sure you're pronouncing them correctly. There's a great little book called That's Easy for You to Say, Your Quick Guide to Pronouncing Bible Names by Broadman and Holman. It's got even a CD where you can hear it, but also a pronunciation guide so you don't, you know, sound like a Neanderthal in terms of how you handle the names. I will tell you a story. No, I better not. I don't have time. Dan Wallace's book, Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, very helpful beyond just your basic Greek. As far as sermon preparation and exegesis, These are books, again, a list that are very helpful. John Broadus is the classic. That's an interesting story. You know the story of John Broadus' book on the preparation and delivery of sermons? He taught at Southern at the time of the Civil War. And after the Civil War, he taught a course on preaching. And because the student population was decimated by the Civil War, he had one student, and that student was blind. And so for the benefit of that student, so the notes could be read to him, he produced his notes. And the fruit of that is on the preparation and delivery of sermons that are in so many seminaries across the world today. Interesting story of God's providence. Fee's book, How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth, and New Testament Exegesis, both very helpful. Kaiser's book, I'll talk more about that as we get into the syntactical analysis, but that was a foundational book for me in my seminary experience. John's book, Rediscovering Expository Preaching. I got a chapter in The Shepherd's Preacher. You can take a look at that. Richard Ramish's book, Preaching Expository Sermons, is helpful. DTS guy, but still very helpful. Little book. Not everything, but many good things. John Stott's Between Two Worlds, sort of the big, embracing the big picture. And then Vines and Shattuck's book, Power in the Pulpit, How to Prepare and Deliver Expository Sermons. You know, if you've heard Jerry Vines, you know, I mean, he wouldn't necessarily be our model. It's not like everything that he would do, I would say, do that. But the book is very good, very helpful. In terms of general reference works, I have two sets. I have, in terms of Bible encyclopedias, I have the International Standard Bible Encyclopedia in four volumes. I also have the old five-volume one, but you can't really get that today. I also have the Zondervan Pictorial. Is it four volumes or five volumes? Five volumes. This is a helpful little book that is hard to find, but if you can find it, I think it may be out of print. I hope it's going to come back in print. Alan Cairns, Dictionary of Theological Terms. He's out of the Free Presbyterian Church, actually, but a good guy, very helpful book. Of course, Calvin's Institutes, Elwell's Evangelical Dictionary of Theology. All of these will be in what you receive. I love John's MacArthur Topical Bible. That's basically Torrey's topical textbook. We added, when we were producing that at Grace to You, we added about 10% more to it, things we wished had been dealt with. A very helpful resource. One that I've just started using over the last couple of years is McGrath and Mansers, Packers, Wiseman's Zondervan Dictionary of Bible Themes. Again, topical. If you're in a passage that's dealing with justification, you want to know kind of where that's dealt with in other ways. Very helpful little resource. And I love Thomas and Gundry's Harmony of the Gospels. I have a copy of that both at home and at the office at church, and I use that even when I'm not studying the Gospels, just in my own life and study. I really enjoy it. Commentaries on Romans. I've got a bunch of them here that I have and read through each week. The key ones are the ones I have you reading, the ones that I've found consistently the most helpful, Douglas Moo and Leon Morris. And then there's some other honorable mentions. And then some library resources. You know, how do you decide which the best commentaries? I really like Best Commentaries website. Many of you are familiar with that. It pulls together the thoughts of a lot of different people. Carson's New Testament Commentary Study, as well as Ross Cup's Commentaries for Biblical Expositors. I don't think you can get Pope's Dictionary of Exegetical Aids or Directory of Exegetical Aids for Bible Translators from the Summer Institutes of Linguistics. I've looked and can't find it, but that's a really helpful little book as well. So that's just a little bibliography of things I have and use that are around me in both of my offices and use all the time. And in some of the cases, I have them duplicated in both places because I study there. If you can afford to do that, you don't have to carry them back and forth. But if you can't, it's worth having them and carrying them because they're very valuable. All right, any questions before we finish today? Yes, sir.
You have some heavy shepherding things that you're looking, that's towards the end of the week, that you're, and here you are in the Monday or Tuesday, getting ready to study, but your mind is just not engaging into that because your heart is heavy about what's going to be happening. Or it might not even be shepherding, but just things like that that are there. How do you rid of, quote, those distractions to help you focus mm-hmm. on the study?
Well, that's a great question, but I think a lot of it has to do with how you arrange your week. I think you have to know yourself, you have to know your congregation, and say, okay, when can I schedule my study time to be the freest? You can never be completely free. Look, it's pastors. We're like Paul. We carry the troubles of our people around on our shoulders. I mean, you're never completely free of that. But you do want to think, okay, I don't want to schedule that meeting Friday. I want to schedule that meeting Tuesday, you know. So you can make some of those decisions. But I think in the end, though, you just have to go into your study and you have to pray for a free mind. Say, Lord, I want to love your word. These problems have always existed. In fact, in many cases, the problems these people have, they took decades to get into this situation. So it's not an emergency. But my being ready to love Christ by loving his people and feeding them on Sunday is crucial. And just being committed to it. So a lot of it happens right here, you know. It's remembering what's really important. I love John 21 because Jesus said the best way we can love him is by feeding his sheep. So I can be in my study and love Jesus by being prepared to feed his sheep. And so it's not to say the individual isn't important. They are. But it's just a different order of magnitude.